Hi, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Creature Features.
Oh, g'day, everyone, and hi, Adam.
Hey, Modi. You know, I'm feeling great today. How about you?
Oh, yeah, well, I slept well, and I'm rearing to go, just like this huge horse.
Well, that's great, because, you know, today's show is action-packed.
Well, I'll do my best to stay awake then. Oh, that tickles.
Well, you're better, because if you don't, you'll miss all the action.
Oh, did someone say action?
Yeah, Marty, I just did.
Well, come on, let's get going. I'm ready. Come on.
All right, well, let's start with what's on today's show.
Oh, good idea.
Coming up on Creature Features, we'll meet a beautiful Arabian horse. We'll show you how to make a groovy pom-pom rug. Meet a wildlife vet, and Shani Vinson from Home and Away introduces us to her water-loving Labrador, Mocha.
We love horses on Creature Features. Really, we do. And we've featured all sorts of horses, from the largest, the Shire horse, to the smallest, the Shetland. And now we're going to check out a really exotic breed. If you like fancy dress, and a horse that just wants to be your best friend, then you're just going to love the Arabian horse. Meet Tiffany and her beautiful Arabian, Glowbrook Legend.
Owning a horse is nearly every girl's dream. But imagine having a horse you could dress up in some stunning fashion items.
Hi, I'm Tiffany. Underneath this gorgeous, colourful costume is my Arabian pony, Glowbrook Legend. He's 10 and I love him dearly. The Arabian horse is one of the oldest purebred breeds in Australia. The reason I love them so much is because they're intelligent and love to learn.
And Tiffany should know. Her family have been breeding them for over 20 years.
These horses originally came from Arabia, and the Arabian horses have been in Australia for well over 100 years. They were one of the first breeds to come into Australia. Overall, an Arabian derivative should be a good saddle horse, something that's going to be out there in the performance industry, competing at dressage and jumping, showing.
And that's just what Tiffany loves to do. She's got plenty of trophies and ribbons to show for it. To win trophies like this, you need to learn how to plait your horse's mane.
First of all, we divide the mane into equal chunks. Then we plait it down tightly. After plaiting, we have to roll it up into a neat bun. So this is the way that we do it. First, we put the needle and thread through the mane. Then we sort of roll it up. A couple of loops around. You want it to be as tight as possible and as neat as it can be. This is what it turns out like after it's all been done. Now I'm off to go do some dressage.
With such versatility and good looks, it's easy to see why the Arabian is one of the most popular horse breeds in Australia. So what are their defining features?
Some of those characteristics would be his very large, kind eye. His head has a dish. On his ears have a little tip inwards, which makes them really pretty when he's got them pricked. A relatively small muzzle, but quite a large nostril on that muzzle. On his neck, certainly a neck that's got a crest. So in other words, that's this sort of upward curve on his neck. On the bone is strong and dense with a large flat knee, which is a characteristic that gives them longevity as performance horses.
Typical costumes had shells, blue beads, and lots of tassels. And the more gold you had, the more wealthy the family was. In competitions, I get dressed up as well because 50% of the class is judged on the costume, and we're also expected to gallop, like they would in a battle.
some of the really special things I think about Arabians are the fact that they've got these absolutely fabulous personalities. They just want to, they want to be your friend. And the Arabians, when they bred these horses, they used to have them in their tents. They were as important to the family as the actual human family members. And in some cases, they were probably more important. And those characteristics are still in the breed. The fact they want to be your best friend. And if they could be in your bedroom with you, I'm sure they'd get in there.
At the moment, we have a five-month-old foal called Herbie, and I'm hoping that he will turn out to be a superstar.
Some people might call Arabians a little bit mad. You might hear the odd person say they're aloof, you know, that they don't really want to be your best friend. But I think the most people that own an Arabian horse would never go back to another breed.
Arabian horses are my passion, and I wouldn't trade them for any other breed in the world.
They really are great horses for young people.
Arabian horse fact. The Arabian horse has one less vertebrae than other horses.
Today I'm with Chloe and Jackson, and they're having troubles with their dog sleeping. It's not that they don't sleep, it's that they sleep in the wrong places. So Chloe, show us the problem.
Follow me.
I see. So who do we have here anyway?
This is Mr. Whitman, and that's Bunny.
Adam, they're always on this couch and on my brother's bed, and it makes my mum and dad really angry.
I think we need to make some doggy beds for these doggies.
All right, well, let's see what we can come up with. The answer is a pom-pom dog bed. So to start, we need to cut out some cardboard. We need to cut a small piece of cardboard and then cut that to the shape of a bow tie. Alrighty, with your bow ties cut, with a notch at each end, take a piece of string and tie a knot. Now this bit of string is really important because eventually it'll hold your pom-pom together. Now the secret to good pom-poms is lots of loops. The more loops you do, the thicker the pom-pom. And the thicker the pom-pom, the more comfy the bed. Now the next step is to tie your pom-pom together. Now this stage is really important because if you don't tie it tight enough, your pom-pom will fall apart. Now, the final step in the creation of our pom-poms. It's time to turn it over and cut. And there we have it, our first pom-pom. Okay, once you made enough pom-poms, you need to arrange... Oh, sorry, dude. You need to arrange them on top of this piece of coloured hessian. That's going to be the base of our dog rug. Once you've placed all the pom-poms on the hessian, remove them and mark their positions so you know where to attach them later. Alright, we've come to the final stage of our dog bed. What we need to do is sew each pom-pom to its designated spot using a darning needle and some thread. Hold it up. Oh, that looks great. Now let's go see if these dogs can get some shut-eye. Come on. Right, the moment of truth. Come on, here you go. It's time to check out another animal myth. And today, it's about these cute, lovable characters, the koala.
Yep.
And the myth is, they sleep all the time because they get drunk on gum leaves. Yep. Let's spin the wheel and see if it's true.
Eucalyptus leaves don't make koalas drunk. Koalas appear drunk or lazy because they've adopted a low-energy lifestyle to compensate for their very low-energy diet. The 600 to 800 grams of eucalyptus leaves that koalas eat every day only gives them the same amount of energy that a single serve of breakfast cereal gives to us.
See? I didn't think you looked drunk, little fella.
You asked for it.
Yes, it's time for You Asked For It. And I'm so glad you asked about otters, because they're just one of my favourite animals. It's so cute. So here's otter keeper Megan Lewis to answer all your questions.
Are otters mammals? From Gina.
Otters are mammals, and what makes them mammals is that they're able to maintain their own body temperature. They have a lovely covering of fur, and when the females give birth to their young, they actually suckle them on milk through their teats.
Do otters have sharp teeth? From Claire.
Well, Claire, they certainly do have sharp teeth, so much so that they can break open the shells of crabs and mussels. And we here at the zoo as keepers have to be very careful that we don't get bitten.
What do otters like to eat? From Liz.
Well, Liz, the oriental small-clawed otters here at the zoo like to eat frogs, snails, mussels, crabs and small fish.
Can I have an otter as a pet? From Jill.
No, you could not have one as a pet. However, there are some fishermen in parts of Southeast Asia that have developed a relationship with some of these otters and help them to catch fish.
Yeah.
See, weren't those otters cute? All right, later in the show, we're going to keep following that tale and see how Jake the Musk is doing at the racetrack. Then we're going to meet actress Shani Vincent from Home and Away and her Labrador Mocha. But right now, it's time for Moddy's Extreme Machine.
And today's extreme creation is the scariest. First, take one hairy-legged Australian trailer, also known as a bird-eating spider. Add the tail, head and dripping fangs of the world's longest venomous snake, the cobra. And, of course, a pair of fresh wings of the blood-sucking vampire bat variety. Oh, yeah! Now, scary wouldn't be scary without crocodile jaws. Ooh, and perhaps a few extra teeth. With up to 3,000 choppers, the great white shark will spare a few. And now for the final touch. Ooh, just a sec. Ta-da! Let me introduce you to the great Cobtar Croc Bat, commonly known as Fido. Come, Fido. Nice boy. Oh, nice boy. Boy, now that is scary.
Wow.
Let's do it.
It's part of his training regime.
Last time on Follow That Tale, we met a young horse, Jake the Musk, who just didn't want to race. But it appears, though, under the guiding hand of Rick Worthington and his team, he may have changed his mind. Now, today's exercise is the last hurdle for Jake. If he does well today, he's off to the races. Morning, Rick.
Morning, how are you?
Good, thank you. Cold, very cold.
It's cold, all right.
It is.
Yeah, we're pretty excited because, this is Jake's last opportunity to sort of show us what we need to see prior to him going to the races. So, you know, we're sort of very excited and looking forward to watching him do this piece of work. Mm-hmm. And that's going to give us our indication of how we're going to go Friday. Today, Luke is going to take Jake out onto the course proper and he'll work off at half pace from the 1,200 metre mark and then just quicken up a little bit up the straight.
It's about 8 degrees out here this morning. It's freezing, but Rick and his whole team are out here with a few other horses, but Jake just looks amazing.
We need to see that Jake's alert, he's focused, and physically and mentally that he's ready to take the next step and go to the races. We know he's healthy. We know he's been eating well and around the stables he's great. But we need now to see Jake put that onto the racetrack.
Well, Rick, how did that go?
It was very, very good.
Yeah?
Actually, I think we're pretty close to the mark.
Mm-hmm.
The horse is really focused and he did a really nice piece of work then. He was on the job. Mentally is there. We know physically is there. I reckon bring it on. We look forward to Friday and let's see him at the track.
Now I'm not going to give him a kiss, but I really do like you, Jake. Yes. Good boy. Next week on Follow That Tale, we'll be trackside to help Jake on the bid stage and cheer him across the finish line, no matter what position he comes. But just quietly, I reckon he's in with a chance.
Oh, Oh, yes, I am the champion. Oh, cool.
Oh, looking flash, buddy.
Oh, thank you.
Hey, have you ever considered what happens to birds when they hurt their wings and can't fly?
Birds that can't fly. My favourite.
Oh, come on, be nice. Imagine how difficult it would be to lose the ability to fly.
Adam, I've never had the ability to fly. I can jump, but I can't fly.
Yeah, I know. I was talking metaphorically.
Are you trying to confuse me?
No, I'm not. Come on, be serious. If birds hurt their wings, what happens?
I know. They go to the bird vet.
Yes, correct.
It is.
Yes, it is. Let's meet Michael Payne, a wildlife vet, and see how he does it.
Hi, I'm Michael. I'm one of the vets here at Crumbin Sanctuary. Today we're going to look at some amazing birds and we'll run through a procedure called imping that restores the flight to birds with damaged feathers. I wish that I could fly into
the sky, so very high. Many of Michael's ex-patients still live in the sanctuary and they're all making an excellent recovery.
This is Brad. He's one of the Brahmini kites here at the sanctuary. Brad actually came in through the wildlife hospital. He arrived in quite a bad way. We did a fair bit of work with Brad, and as you can see, he settled down quite nicely. Now, this is one of our amazing nocturnal Australian birds. This is a tawny frogmouth, and his name's Snot, and I'm not sure how he earned that. So we've got a special treat for Snot since he's been such a good lad today.
Mmm, yummy. Today, Michael is treating a malnourished little kite that has an overgrown beak and is finding it difficult to eat and hard to preen itself.
You can see this bird's beak's actually very overgrown and we just need to trim it back a little bit to help him eat. With birds, the safest way to give an anaesthetic is with some gas. It's a very quick-acting anaesthetic, so he should be asleep within about 30 seconds. So you can see he's just starting to fall asleep there now. The eyes are getting heavy. Really, this lower beak is the main problem, and we need to take about 3, maybe 4 millimetres off this and just trim the upper beak back a little. Without a good, effective beak, it really one of these birds of prey are going to starve. Yeah, I think I'll leave it there. I'm really happy with the way that's coming together now. So now what we'll do is have a close look over this Brahmini kite. It's a great opportunity for us to be able to have a close examination of the bird while it's under anaesthetic. So we'll take that chance and we'll have a good look. We've noticed that this bird's just a touch lame on its right foot. So I just want to have a close look at that. But while he's under anaesthetic, we'll take the opportunity to take a quick x-ray of that foot.
X-ray!
Wings and feathers are absolutely crucial for birds of prey. If they can't fly well and quickly, then they can't catch their food. Really, we're looking at the primary flight feathers on the end of the wing and then the secondary flight feathers coming more down on the inside. If we look at this Brahmini kite's feathers, they're slightly damaged here on the tips. But if these feathers were damaged to a point where they're missing perhaps half of the feathers, what we'd have to look at doing is actually putting some other feathers onto this bird to replace the damaged ones. To do that, we use a technique called imping, and it is a technique that works very well.
Michael practices this amazing technique quite often on injured birds that arrive in his surgery. It's an old technique dating back many years, but how do you do it?
We need to pretend that this feather is really attached onto the wing, pretty much at that position. So the feather shaft's actually held in position there into the wing. So what I'll do now is I'll cut the feather at this point. And as you can see, the actual feather shaft is hollow, and that gives us space to be able to slide this bit of bamboo down the middle of the feather. So we'll put a little bit of super glue on that to hold it there. So now what we'll do is we take the good feather and we'll cut it in exactly the same position, right at the base where the feather's just starting to come off the shaft. Again, we'll put the super glue on, slide it up into position. And we've got our new feather. And that is really an exact replica of the feather that we had previously, but it's a lovely, healthy feather. It's time to wake this little guy up and he should recover quite quickly. Really, we're looking about 3 to 5 minutes and he should be well awake. We've got the x-rays through now from the Brahmini kite. You may remember he had that injury on his leg. This is the joint here that we were concerned about, and everything's looking just as it should on the x-ray. So I'm happy to say that there's no serious problems, and really this is just, it's a good example of the type of work we do, and it's all in a day's work here at the hospital.
And now it's time for Celebrity Pets.
Well, I'm going to let you in on a little secret. Before I started Creature Features, I may have been on one or two other TV shows. And today, I'm going to hang out with somebody that I met whilst filming Home and Away. And luckily, she's got the afternoon off. She's going to introduce us to her dog,
Mocha.
Hi, Shani.
I'm good, how are you?
So tell me a bit about Mocha.
Oh, well, Mocha's my beautiful puppy. He's still a puppy, even though he's really big.
He's massive.
Yep, he's only 3.5 years old. He's got a lot of energy, much like myself, and, yeah, he's beautiful.
And the boxing gloves, the next Rocky Balboa, what's going on?
I love to box, good way to keep fit, super tough. And I'm just doing it for a storyline, actually, that I'm about to do in Home and Away as a pro boxer. I'll show you who's walking around. Okay, Adam, before we head to the beach, there's this really cool trick that he does and that we just have to show you.
I can't wait to see it.
Okay, cool.
Oh, nice car.
Thank you. All right, let's do this.
I'm curious, Shani.
You are in for a treat, trust me. It's going to be so good. Okay, so we're going to lay two Lilos because the swimming pool's a little bit smaller than we first thought. Ready? Go! Go, go, go! Good boy, go, go! Mocha, go! Get it! Well done.
Now, how did you teach him that?
I told you he'd do it. See, you just got to have some faith.
He's very energetic. He loves the water.
He does. He loves the water. You should see him down the beach. Loves the ocean.
Yeah, well, let's head down there.
All right.
So tell me, what's on the horizons? Work-wise,
okay, well, actually, something I've been meaning to ask you about. I'm hoping you could help me out a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a big one, so fingers crossed.
I'll see what I can do.
Okay, well, I'm going for this big movie role.
All right.
And it's of this cool new young cadet reporter, and she's really nervous.
Okay.
And for her first interview, she has to interview a massive Hollywood star, so of course she's really, really nervous.
Yes.
And I've never done this before. I've only ever been on the receiving end of interviews. So I was wondering if you could do me a really huge favour and switch roles with me for a little minute and be the big Hollywood star and I can interview you.
Well, sure, you know, I won't have to try that hard to be a big Hollywood... No, of course I can help you out. Yeah, that'd
awesome.
Be great.
Let's give it a shot. Okay, what does Jet Li do in the film besides fight all the bad guys?
His characters are very in-depth and there's a lot of emotion to his characters, I think, that come out, besides the martial arts, yeah.
Right, and he does some pretty cool moves. I was trying to do them the other day and I had no idea how to do it, but, you know, I gave him
like... Again, they probably don't really want to know, like, about you.
Sorry,
they really want to know
like
this character.
I'm
like,
a bit pain right here.
Yeah, and that's not a good start either. Alright, so there's those few points to remember. Mm-hmm. We want the wireless mic. But mainly, presence, just keep it calm, do your research.
Yep.
I'll be fine.
I stand a good chance.
You do.
Okay, good. Yeah. I feel confident.
Good, so you should. So tell me, what happens at the end of the movie?
Oh, at the end of the movie, she has a very big decision to make. Mm-hmm. She falls in love with Jet Li and the big movie star, and she has to decide whether she wants to pursue her love or her love for her career.
Oh, I see.
I like that. Yeah.
Okay. Well, so we could probably even play that scene out here.
Let's give it a go. So, Adam, the end of the movie is really hard for her because she's got to make a big decision and she's got to choose between her love for the man and her love for her career, and she really doesn't know what to do. and she's looking at the guy and she thinks, oh, I could easily go that way, and then she's looking at the road and she's got this awesome car and she's not 100% sure. And then I think at the end she just decides she's going to have to go with her...
I think she'll be great, eh? She's got that down pat. She's a confident young actress. Oh, she'll be fine. Hey, is she coming back? Hey, Shani, wait up. Hey, Shani.
Yeah, listen, by the way, that wasn't me, okay?
Yeah.
Now, listen, Shani was just so nice. Do you think I could get a part on Home and Away?
Well, yeah, sure you could. But would you rather be home or away?
Oh, Adam, cats are always much happier at home.
Well, but you know, Creature Features wouldn't be the same without you.
Really? You'd miss me if I wasn't here.
Well, could I think about that and get back to you?
Oh, on second thoughts, I'm much happier here with you, Adam.
Well, nice. Since you're sticking around, let's check out what's on our next show.
Ooh, cool.
Next time on Creature Features, meet some native bees that don't sting. Create a special designer bag. We'll join a marine biologist on a dugong adventure. And NRL star Adam McDougall introduces us to his best friend, Max.
So join us next time for more animal adventures on Creature Features. But in the meantime, you can check out our website, which is abc.net.au.
/creaturefeatures.
See you next time, everyone.
Oh, bye for now. Oh, I'm so glad I decided to stay.
Oh, so am I, yeah, buddy. Oh.